In today's installment of Unpacked.
You can see when your mom, she's in pain. Then when I go to the hospital, then on the bed that she was lying on, she was not there.
Mm.
In order for you guys to be able to keep on staying here, you need to find me someone.
Mm.
And then I tried it to clean. It was on Sunday.
So you were going to stop going to school to clean the house? What happens when a child finds themselves homeless with their younger brother and they have nowhere to go? Today's guest is here to tell his story. Let's unpack. The passing of his mother left the then 16-year-old Thabo Jama and his brother with nowhere to go and no one to turn to. This dire situation, marred by grief and rejection, led to Thabo and his brother having to beg on the streets. This is part one of Thabo's story. Let's unpack. Thabo, welcome to the show. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me. Thank you.
So take me back to what your upbringing was like, your early childhood memories.
Honestly speaking, my background was not one of those rosy backgrounds.
Hmm.
It was just a normal background for me.
Hmm.
So what I can say is, we survived. When I say we, I mean my mother.
Mm.
And my younger brother, we survived through God until she passed on. Yeah.
So it was you, your younger brother, and mama, just the three of you. What
actually,
who was
I
in
do
the
have
home?
Other sibling.
Mm.
Actually, an extra sibling, which is my sister. Mm. But most of the time, she was living far away.
Mm.
So the person that I grew up next to is my mother and my younger brother by that time, yeah.
And what was mom doing for a living when you were growing up?
My mom was a domestic. Actually, she has been a domestic worker according to what she told us growing up. Mm. Remember, my mother apparently doesn't know her real family, like her own mother, her own grandfather. So apparently they had to survive through domestic work to get where they were. As I'm saying, she's always been a domestic worker.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So now, you know, in that time, where did you guys grow up? And what was that life like? I know you're saying you survived through God and it wasn't rosy.
Yes.
But tell me what the life was like.
Okay. Most of the time, as I said, as my mom being a domestic worker, we grew up in different households of being a domestic worker.
Mm.
She would stay here. Maybe a year, get another job.
And you were able to live with her where she was working?
Okay. But some workers, or let me rather say...
some employers.
The employers.
Yes.
Some would say, no, we don't want kids.
Yes.
Some they would allow. Some had no choice but to allow.
So are you saying that you were able to live with your mom at the employer's house?
Yes, at the back room.
Yes.
We would mostly most of all our times would stay with my mom.
Yeah.
Remember, some employers, they would not allow her to do that.
Yeah.
But she would tell them, Hore, where do you expect me to take my kids to?
Mm.
So we would stay with my mother.
Mm.
And then there are rules when you're staying with your mother at your employer's house.
Mm.
You're not allowed to open the gate the way you want. You're not allowed to make noise. You're not allowed to do one and two and three. So we had to live by the rules.
And then school, what happened with school?
I was still schooling. I was still schooling. I would travel.
Mm.
Sometimes I would travel without any money. Because remember, I know I was young, but I remember my mom used to get paid 300 rand by the time.
A day or?
A month.
A month?
I swear.
How long ago was this?
My mom passed on in 2004. So it was just before 2004. Let's say, if I remember correctly, somewhere around 2001, going there. And then that's when she got another job. Then
so she was paid 300 rand a month.
And then I think later, 2003, she got another job. For her, it was much better pay by the time. She was getting 800 rand a month because apparently the reason why she was getting that money, it was because she was using the back room.
Mm.
So meaning half of whatever they said half of her salary, the reason why she's getting 800 is to pay for the back room because...
For rent, basically.
Yes, because we were also staying there.
Okay. So now what school, I mean, just in terms of, I'm assuming your mom was working in the suburbs.
Yes,
and now where was your school? Was it in the township or where was
it
your school?
It was in the township, yes.
Okay, so you had I would travel. Yes.
Remember, I would travel every day. Mm. So sometimes I would have money to go to school. Mm. By the time I didn't have money, obviously I have to start begging. That's where the begging part started.
But this is before your mom passed.
It was before, because remember, she was not getting a lot.
Oh, okay.
Because my younger brother is also there.
Yes.
He's still in crèche. They took him to, I don't like it to call it this way, but it's a white school.
Yes.
Crèche.
Yes.
So there was a percentage that the employer of my mom used to take from that 800 rand to say, remember, ngwanaga o tsena crèche, so now we're going to take 200 rand. Because
for the school fees.
Apparently, there was a say that, Ramotanya school. We're taking your child to school.
Yes.
And then we'll be paying for everything. Mm. But we need an extra 200 rand from your salary, meaning you're getting 600 rand.
Nakoya guy, if...
They say, according to every conversation they used to have, because my mother's employer, she was a very loud person.
Mm.
So she would just call my mom out of the blue and say, okay, fine. I've got a letter from the school. So month end, I'm taking 200 rand because I want to do 1, 2, and 3 for the child. Yeah, so because my mom was comfortable with that 800 rand. Let me tell you something. She felt like it was money.
Well, if you were earning 300, but 800 is nothing.
Yes.
It's very, very little money.
No, it's nothing.
So tell me now about how you started begging, because you're saying that there wasn't now enough money for you to go to school at some point to travel.
To travel. Mm. So I would basically hukupa chelte on the street when I see someone.
Mm. Well, that's school uniform?
Definitely. Mm. And remember, they used to call me 50 cent. Because I used to take hukupa 50 cent.
Mm.
By that time, we were not calling it 50 cent, nearly 5 bob.
Mm.
So every person that I would see in a hukupa 5 bob, they would give me a hukupa 5 bob. I would even forget that the same person in 5 bob, I asked him like 5 minutes ago.
Yes.
Because remember, it was my job.
Yes.
It was my job to get that money. Whatever, if it's going to be extra, I would make sure I get a sharp when I come back. I used to take care of my mom when I was very young, and she didn't like it.
Mm.
But I would make sure for whatever money that it was given to me on the street, because I knew the situation. Sometimes in the Honorable Papa fail, understand, or Kamotoho. And then I would see what it was breaking my mother.
Mm.
But it was also breaking me too. Because as young as I was, I knew the situation. I could see what this is what's happening.
Mm.
So whatever amount that I would ask, I would make sure it's extra. Get saying something. And then when I come home, oh God.
Mm.
Yeah. When I come home, kids like regular shabu, and then I would lie because she didn't like me begging, but she said, I could see she doesn't like it. She was not condoning me. Do you understand? But you can see when your mom, she's in pain. She would go around the house and then come back, matlaga and then read. She was very light in complexion. So you could see how she was crying. And then give mother mom lelang about hi. Negative something. Then yeah. But I could see what was happening.
Mm. Yes. So for like how much money did you have to raise for transport?
Like 10 rand.
So when
it was
you get,
10 rand.
So after 10 rand you make sure you've got enough.
I knew what Wabananga graph 5 rand. Definitely I'm going to school. I would make sure. And then if it was extra, then I knew how okay, it was then it would be. Because it was cheap. Text was cheap at the time. Yeah.
So where was your you said your younger brother and local crèche at this time?
We were all staying together.
Okay. So as time went on, what were some of the changes that took place? Was this just something you kept doing until?
Remember, you get comfortable.
Mm.
You get comfortable. Because I remember growing up, I didn't understand. Mama gana tholari, no, let's go to the shops. Mm-hmm. So I didn't understand by the time, what does she mean when she says, waskapara di tlhako? Then we would just walk barefoot. And then when we get into a store, to a certain store, and then na re le ka ntse di tlhakos gore apara wa bona ha o fetse apara and then she would be like walk out and don't look o se tshaba maoto just walk out wa ngana sene at first I didn't understand it gore what was happening so na re apara di tlhako I remember every Christmas whatever na re apara di tlhako retswa but I didn't understand it until I started growing gore oh actually this is why because remember she couldn't afford to buy us new clothes, new shoes, and everything.
So what is your understanding of what she was doing?
According to my understanding, I'm not promoting anything. I'm not promoting her right, but she did what she had to do. She did what she had to do.
And she never got caught?
Never, not that I remember of. Not that I remember of. Her previous life, I don't know what was happening. The only moments that I had, that I've experienced, it was the time, let's say, when I was born and then when I was a bit clever to understand some certain things until 2014. I mean, 2004, that's when
things changed.
Then what was happening and everything. Yeah.
Okay, so what happened then in 2004?
2004, I remember it was on my younger brother's birthday. Actually, my mom started getting sick the same 2004 because she would keep on saying, Tawizi, but I can lose weight. When, how do you see me? I'll be like, mama, go on the right. You understand? And then, yeah, it started. You know, when months passed by, and then I could see changes. My mom, she used to go out a lot with one of the family members. She was that kind of a woman, making sure we've eaten, we've bathed, everything is fine. Then she goes out. So, it started when she started not going out at all. Then in my mind, I was like, why mama sakholazama? So we got excited, or at least now she's here. So apparently she got the news before we even knew what was happening.
So what were the news?
The news that it was that she's HIV positive. And back then, HIV positive was one of the scariest things to understand. So according to what I understand, most of the time, unadula Allah, she would cry. Because every time when she would look at my younger brother, unadula Allah, but I didn't understand her why. To understand, she started like taking care of him more than me. So I think that was the sign to say, because remember 2004, if you knew you were HIV, you know how you are dying.
But she never ever told you?
She never said anything, because I remember, I think probably she spoke to family members, I don't know. But there was a time whereby one of the family members came and then they started saying, Mama unalis jeso, ujisitwi. So in my mind, Mama unalisitwi, in my mind. Then Bamotseba Misego, one of the traditional doctors, and all those things. That's when she started getting sick more. Because I remember Mama Naya clinicking all the time. Bamufa medication. And then somehow she would stop. Bamotseba Misego to traditional doctor. And then apparently they were like draining everything. Yeah. Then she started becoming very weak.
Yeah.
I remember it was 2004 on the 20th of October. It was... It was, actually, she got admitted to hospital. Then every time I got to school, I would go on Mona, because we were not far from the hospital. I would go, come back, because remember, my younger brother, Lena, so I have to go and fetch him, make sure that I make food, Raja. So on the 20th of October, I just woke up. Like, I was very tired. I remember I was so tired. And then it was a normal school day. Then I decided to say, today I'm not going. I said to my younger brother, you are also not going. Then I left him, cleaned, cooked, did whatever that I did. And then I remember I cooked pap and spinach. My mom, she used to love spinach. Then I cooked pap and spinach on that day. And then I said, I'm taking this to my mom. Then when I got to the hospital, then on the bed that she was lying on, she was not there. Then I went in and then I asked, where's my mother? And then they said, no, we moved her somewhere. Then I said, because yesterday I came and saw her, is she being discharged? Then they were like, no, don't worry, she's okay. Then I said, no, but the question that I'm asking, am I going with my mother today? So that's when I saw this nurse. she started crying, but I thought maybe she was crying because she was feeling pity for me for whatsoever. That's when they asked me to go back home. Mm. And then they said to me, listen, just go back home. And then your mom will come tomorrow. Mm. Today we're going to be busy. We say we're going to bath her and everything. Mm. Then when I got back home, Gandhi, the employer, she knew. They called her.
Oh.
They told her. When I got back home, I remember there was a big party there for my younger brother because it was his birthday.
Mm.
I think he was turning 6 or 7. I can't remember. Mm. Then when we got there, there was balloons and everything.
Mm.
Then I even forgot that it was his birthday. Mm. That's when, okay, they started having fun, eating everything. And then later on, that's when the news broke.
Mm.
Yeah.
And it was the boss who came to tell you guys.
She told us, I remember. Because that day we were getting everything, like free food. She even bought me presents. Because it was not even my birthday, but we got everything. Mm. So I was like, oh, I wonder today we do medicine. And then we got everything. So that's when later on she broke the news. Yeah. Mm.
So what changed, what happened like after then?
Then after that, she came. I remember it was 3 days or 4 days later when my mom passed. She came to me and asked me, do I know any family member that would love to come and work on behalf of my mother?
Mm.
My mom was not buried yet.
Yeah.
And then I said, I don't know nothing at the moment, but I will look. Do you understand? Then the funeral, I remember my mother's sister came. They came to negotiate with my mother. She has been working there. Is there anything that they'll be giving?
Yes.
I remember they gave her 1,000 rand.
Mm.
And then, because why I'm saying 1,000 rand, I heard when my mother's sister complaining, saying, how can they give her 1,000 rand after the years that my mom worked and everything. Mm. And then, yeah, that's when I remember that conversation, to understand? Because I remember them saying, Hori, my mom doesn't have a funeral burial thing. And everything. So it took them something like 2 weeks to bury my mother.
Mm.
And then apparently there was money to Hori Bamrakelele Kasi. But there was no fancy food like we're eating today.
Yeah.
There was only, I remember, I hate those biscuits even today.
Mm.
When I did biscuit eating, it was 10 cents by the time. They only bought that, the juicy. Mm. And then I remember, Bamuluki like a van. You see, van, like, it's just a van.
Mm.
Because apparently, hash, it was supposed to be paid and everything. So Bamutinagamo, I remember I was, Bamarawa van. I can't remember where was my little brother, but it was me on Negeloko Marago. And then Lekas Selahaneludi, so I think I was sitting on the side.
Mm.
I was not crying. I said to you, why was I so? I said, why are you here? See, no, who is going to
happen?
But I don't know what's going to happen, but the way you are being buried, I'm going to rebury you one day.
Mm.
I'm going to work hard and make you proud. Because the way you are being buried, that's not how you are supposed to be buried. Then I remember everything just went.
And in that time, Nonzo dula ko bedroom.
Naredula le mama.
And where was the? Because it was just the two of you now.
It was the two of us, yes. And then family members started coming, but what a cheka. Because they wanted to, according to my understanding, funerally pass.
Yes.
It was supposed to pass.
Yeah.
Even the my mom's employer, she didn't say anything. She never came and asked me again if I could find someone. Wang understand. I think for now, it's everything, it must pass. Then everything passed. And then I remember Mama Kanana Lydia Paro sitting at that. And then there was a time where I moved to then my sister came. And then when my sister came, she refused to give away my mom's clothes.
So just so I understand, your sister and you share a father or a mother?
We say the same mother, the same mother and same father, yeah.
Yes, okay.
Yeah, and then she came and then she decided to take everything. And then I remember her words, she said, I'm keeping everything.
Mm.
My family members were not happy.
Mm.
I remember they were not happy. They started saying things, Like they started saying things, understand? And then my sister took her clothes. My sister by that time need to let her boyfriend. That's how she.
Analin, how many years?
I can't remember.
Oh, alright.
Yeah.
Okay.
So need to let her boyfriend. Most of the time, I do like understand? So yeah, that's when everything has started. And then we, after the burial, we had to go back home. Going back home, where do I go? We're going back where my mom used to stay. And then when we
got... And where was that?
In Krugersdorp.
Oh,
in
okay.
the same... at the same employer's house. Yes. We got back there and then the employer called me and said to me... She used to call me Simon. Simon...
Is that a second name?
That's my second name. And then she said to me, okay, your mom, she's been buried. You need to find me someone who can come and work here. Yeah. I have to find her someone who can work here, someone that she trusts. And then after that, and then she said to me, in order for you guys to be able to keep on staying here, you need to find me someone. And then I asked around, then I said, let me work. Then I decided to say, let me work. And then she said to me, can you be able to clean the house? I said, yes, I can. And then she said...
And you were how old at the time?
I was... When my mom passed, I was 16. I was 16 and I'm still schooling, by the way. And then I tried it to clean. It was on Sunday.
So you were going to stop going to school to clean the
yes,
house?
Yes, that was the whole concept of everything. Remember,
and she agreed.
It was my mom was buried on Saturday.
Yeah.
Then it was Sunday. Sunday we're going back.
Yes.
And on Sunday, apparently the house was dirty and everything. She got annoyed to say the house is dirty and everything. Then I tried. I tried wherever that I could. I remember when she said to me, you clean better than your mother. I swear in front of God's eyes. I remember her words, you clean better than your mother. When she said that, then something came and said, you can clean this house. Do you understand?
But you're supposed to be in school, you're a child.
I didn't think about school by that time.
No, but it was her responsibility as an adult.
Yes.
You know,
because
what she was doing was illegal.
Yes.
So she then agreed that you're going to stop going to school to clean her house.
She never exactly said, we agree that you stop schooling. She just said, you clean better than your mother. I will see you tomorrow. So
but
tomorrow
she knew,
is Monday.
She knew that tomorrow being Monday means you're not going to school.
She knew. Then I stopped. For the whole week, I started cleaning. I got tired.
And wait, what was the agreement as to how you get paid?
But we never spoke about it. The only thing that was running in my mind, remember, she said to me, when I find someone who can be able to do this job, then you are safe to have
somewhere to live. Okay.
Then I said, no, I'll be doing it. For a week, I got tired. I said, no, 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 I can't do this. And then I called one of my aunts, and then one of my aunts sent it to one of my cousins, one of my cousin's sister. Then she came. I think she worked for 2 months, if I'm not mistaken. And then she started saying, hey, the payment is too little. Then I asked her, how much are you getting? Then she was like, no, she's getting 400 rand.
How?
Then I said to her, Mos mama nagra 800. Then she said to me, hey, nabari ban zama pile ka 400, ba batlo bona gore how clean am I? And then she worked for 2 months. She got tired also. And then she said, no, that's money that she's giving me. It's too little. Then I remember I said to her, no, let's go because Lena, I can vow to you. My mom was getting 800. And then I remember we had a conversation with that lady. And then she said to me, hey, I'm giving you 400 rand because your ma, or when I Thabo mama gago, I bought a phone. It was at 3310. I bought a phone. So you and me and your mother, we agreed, Hore, I'm going to deduct 400 rand. I couldn't say she's lying or what, because the proof was there that my mom had a 3310 phone.
Yeah.
And then, yeah, apparently my cousin got tired and then she said to me she was leaving. She told me straightforward. We're
so
very
you,
close.
Were you going to school at the time?
Yes, because I started going to school because of now my cousin, she's here. When
but,
I get home.
But why was there no discussion at that time about you guys going to live with family? Because technically, you were living, the two of you, in the back of someone's house.
Yes, yes.
But you were living alone without an adult.
Yeah. The only adult person, it was my cousin. by the time.
But she wasn't your guardian.
Yeah, I know. I know. What happened was that I remember on the funeral day, after the funeral, actually, when they started sharing all these clothes and everything, I remember there was a meeting where they said, okay, retanga banapa. I understand. And there was a say, like everyone started saying, Hey, now I've got my own problems. Hey, you know, everyone said whatever. They said, unale usabone, usabone will take care of. I understand. That was the discussion. Until my cousin came.
Oh, okay. Yeah. And your sister never came to come and take you guys?
She would come. She would come. Remember, she was not working there. She's living off her boyfriend. One understand that. So, yeah, it was that kind of a life. It was just a disturbing life.
Mm.
Yeah, then my cousin started working. Hence, I said she left the job. After leaving the job, she said to me, yeah, now she's going. Then I said, oh, it means now I have to leave school again and start working. And then after she left, and then the lady, the employer came and started accusing, saying, Hori, my cousin left with her things. She stole her things, her clothes and everything. And then apparently when we were at the funeral, the employer went inside my mom's room. Mm. And then there were things that belonged to them that my mom stole. So now it's time for us to go. And then she said to me, we'll buy you a place where there's a squatter camp, buy you a shack, then you can stay with your brother there. So then she said, I'm giving you guys a month for me to sort out my things, for you also to sort out your things. And then apparently a month came, and then she said she found someone. She found someone. And then after finding someone, we need to go. Then I asked, I said, so you, because you promised us Plega Hudula, so what's happening? And then she said to me, I gave the money to your mother's sister. That's what she said.
Was it true?
Hence, I'm going to say, I don't know what happened. And then my sister went to my mother's sister. And then they started discussing this, and then there were fights. I remember my sister was fighting with my aunt every time. Because mama ufile chelte ya black in you ate it. So every time when she meets up with my aunt, there's always a fight.
Yeah. So let's fast forward now to you guys. She promised you a place, she ends up not getting you a place. So now you find yourselves homeless. What happens?
I remember we were given a month.
Yes.
So the month came, and then I went to one of my other aunts, because I knew she couldn't afford us.
Yeah.
And then I think he stayed there for 2 months. And then it was, hey, this and this and this.
And
then,
he was young. How old?
He was young. He was 6 years.
Yes.
6 years going to seven. Was okay, hey, this, hey, that, to understand. And I remember, and I was also staying. Today I'm there, tomorrow I'm there, today I'm there, to understand. So now I have to go pick him up, and then I have to see Jorge Zangayen, I understand. So I would go to even strangers, do you understand, people that looked familiar to me. So basically, bamotsa. So every time I'm relieved to say, at least, unali wadulanding. Because I took him to my sister, and then, apparently, only to find out in 2 weeks, I attended school. Then I went to my sister, I asked, then I would move him from my sister, and then find someone. That was the life.
Next time on Unpacked.
And then they offered me a place to stay. And then when we were there, he said to me he wants to sleep with me. Started begging, and then I met my mother's old friend. It never took her a week, and then I got a call from Truett's. I was at the graveyard. I said to her, you remember what I promised you, and it's happening today.
Thank you so much for watching Unpacked with Relebogile Mabotja. Make sure you subscribe to my channel where you can get to watch more episodes. But more importantly, you can be part of our online community. Comment down below, share with us who you'd like to see on the show, what story you'd like us to discuss. We love engaging with you. Keep it coming and don't forget to subscribe.